be dismissed. Well, good morning. We're gonna do things a little different even in our teaching time today. Our lights are gonna be a little different. You'll see why that is the case in a minute. So just bear with me. So glad to see everyone here today. It's been just awesome. See some friends. Marty's there. Ambrose and so many others are here. I just want to thank you for visiting. Glad to have you today. So I pray you feel welcome at the Church of Lake Mead. I pray this is a place that you are embraced and welcomed, because we want to be reflections of Jesus. And isn't that the truth about Christ? He was, if you could say anything, he was welcoming. He welcomed everyone.
Amen.
Well, hey, every time around Easter, we take a few services and we focus in on the resurrection. Let me tell you where that came from, why that's the case in my own life, why I always push for a few Sundays where we can focus on the resurrection. About 5 years ago, I was in a master's program at Biola University, and I took a course on the resurrection, and it changed my life. It changed my entire life, changed my entire Christian life. And after that class, happy birthday, Aaron.
Thanks, Brad.
After that class, just everything changed. My Christianity went from a complete faith and trust in what the Bible says. I know that sounds weird, but now my faith was in the empty tomb. And because the empty tomb was empty and Jesus rose, now I believe the Bible. It just changed everything. It became the center of my entire Christian life, the empty tomb. And the more I thought about it and explored it and understood it, the more I realized it's exactly the same reason the disciples believed.
That's right.
Because the tomb was empty and Jesus rose from the dead. And so I grew up in a church culture that put so much emphasis in it, and I love that, they put so much emphasis on believe the Bible, believe the Bible, believe the Bible. It almost became an object of my worship. And really, if you're going to be biblical, which is a little ironic, if you're going to be biblical, the reason you're a Christian is because the tomb is empty.
That's right.
It changed everything. And so I believe the Bible because the tomb is empty.
That's right.
So that lesson was my academic lesson, right? Shortly after I finished the class, someone who I consider my brother died suddenly at 27 years old. And I had to be at his funeral, and I had to preach his funeral. I grew up with this kid. For better or for worse, he lived in our house a lot of his high school years. And he died suddenly at 27. And I was able to say at his funeral, beyond any doubt, my brother was with the living Jesus, because his faith was in the living Jesus. And all who put their trust in him can have that same assurance. And there was such peace and such hope at that funeral. It was almost as if God said, Brad, I'm going to let you take this journey through this academic exercise of learning about the resurrection, and then I'm going to show you how important the resurrection really is. When you're looking at a crowd of people that don't have any hope, and you can say, yeah, I'm sad today, my brother's gone, but I know beyond doubt he's alive.
Amen.
Because the Jesus that completed grave was the Jesus he put his trust in. That was powerful. Ever since then, I've been passionate about the resurrection. I can't read enough about it. I just enjoy it. So this week, we're going to go a different angle than we have in the years past, because I think there's so many different angles to talk about this subject. So I'm going to go a little different angle this week, and it's not going to be all hooping and hollering and emotional. It's going to be kind of meditative, even a little depressive. So I'm sorry, but that's how it is today, okay? Next week will be jubilant and exciting and everything else. This week, not so much, okay? Just warning you ahead of time, that's what we're in for. Is that okay? All right. Well, let me start off with the thought. And here's the thought. This is where my studies have led me this year. We're gonna start with reconstructing the first century if you're a Jew. And what we want to do is we want to think about what would it have been like to be a first century Jew underneath the brutal oppression of the Roman occupiers, of the Roman oppressors. How would that have been for a Jew? In this period in time, there were several, this is my first point, several Jewish messiahs that claimed to be the long-awaited one who would deliver Israel and set them free. Several of them. Jesus was not the only messianic figure in ancient Palestine. That's really key for us to understand. In fact, it's also a historical fact that these messianic movements, and there were several, never survived the death of their leaders. This is due to what is meant by the term Messiah. It literally means anointed one. The one anointed by God who would deliver Israel. So, if a potential Messiah fails to deliver Israel and is instead captured and executed by Rome, this is the surest sign he is a fraud, a false Messiah. Again, as I said, this pattern happened several times in ancient Israel. We're going to look at one in particular later. This leads us to a very perplexing historical question that we are going to ask this week and we are going to answer next week. So there's going to be a little bit of, lack of resolution, I think. Okay? Just warning you. Here's the question. How did the church survive the cross? Maybe more accurately, how did the Jesus movement survive Good Friday? How did the followers of Jesus see that their Messiah, who they were convinced was the long-awaited one, how did the followers of Jesus ever continue that belief after his public execution at the hands of Rome? That's going to be our question we're going to ask today. And we're going to go on a journey. And we're going to try to be one of the characters in the story and feel what it would be like to walk along that journey with Jesus. Would you join me in prayer as we start? Father, I need you so desperately. God, we need you. I'm the one that's going to be delivering this message you've laid on my heart. And the folks in this room, they're going to be receiving this. And so, God, it's on both sides of this equation, we need your Spirit. Would you be the teacher? Would you help us be learners? In Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so let's go back in time and let's try to be a disciple of Jesus. Again, we are not going to understand the end. In fact, I was telling my wife this yesterday. I think as Christians today, we're kind of blessed and cursed because we know the end of the story. We see everything through Easter sunglasses on. Does that make sense? Because of Easter, we interpret the entire gospel story knowing how it's going to play out, knowing how it's going to end. Well, the problem is, these disciples have no clue about Easter. They don't realize he's going to rise from the dead. And so they are thinking what every first century Jew would think. This is a Messiah, and we're going to see how they came to think that. And that Messiah has one job and one job only, and that is to liberate captive Israel. Israel's captive. They're captive to Jews, to the Romans. They're captive to a corrupt temple system. And the Messiah is going to come to deliver captive Israel. Is that making sense? That is what they think. That is what they think all the way through. So let's go on this journey. Look at how it started. If you remember last week, we talked about Jesus on this 40-day fast. When Jesus finishes the 40-day fast, remember, just prior to that 40-day fast, John has baptized Jesus. We see the Spirit of God descending on Christ, and he goes into the wilderness to have those temptations with the enemy there, with the devil. When he's done with the temptations in the wilderness, if you piece the stories together, you have Jesus being kind of reacquainted with John. John then, this is in John chapter 1, John the Baptist points to Jesus and says those famous words, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." So you have John the Baptist, who baptized Jesus 40 days earlier, now sees Jesus after his temptation in the wilderness and points to him as the long-awaited Messiah. At that point, there are two disciples, Andrew and probably probably John, John the writer of the book of John, who then leave following John the Baptist and start to follow Jesus at that time. Right? The reason we're not sure it's John is because he never mentions himself in the book. He's always kind of a weird, like the one Jesus loved, or he's just kind of like in the background, probably for humility. That's why he wrote it that way. And so Andrew then is with Jesus, and Jesus and Andrew start to talk. And Jesus, you know, Andrew says, "Where do you live?" And Jesus says, "Come and see." And so there's this kind of exploration on Andrew's part and on John's part to see, is this Jesus really the long-awaited Messiah? Probably about 2 or 3 weeks later, Jesus then goes up north to Galilee. This kind of happened in the southern part of the country. In the northern part of Galilee is where that story happens, where Jesus sees Andrew and Peter fishing on the Sea of Galilee, along with James and John. These are two sets of brothers. They're all fishermen by trade. And he sees them on the shore of Galilee, and he says, "Come and follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." And that's after he helps him catch that miraculous, you know, draw of fishes. And so at that moment, Peter and John start to follow Jesus. And I want us to think about what it would have been like to be these disciples of Jesus, to be these former fishermen who are now formally invited to follow Jesus. And really, let's just think about that for a second. Here you are, you're called away from your occupation to follow a man who you've been told is the long-awaited Messiah. And now you're kind of in that process of exploring this. Is it really true? Because friends, we've been waiting a long time for a Messiah. We've been waiting an awful long time for someone to set captive Israel free. And so John and Andrew and Peter and James, these four guys, they're listening to Jesus. And what I want to do now is I want to show you this video that kind of like plays the story out from their perspective. That while you watch the video, I want you, again, not to know about Easter. Just put it out of your mind, this whole idea of him rising from the dead. You're a regular Jew in northern Galilee, and you're just thinking about the fact that this guy could possibly be the long-awaited Messiah to set us free. And I think Jesus says a whole lot of things that convinces them that is exactly who he was. Watch this.
Thank you. your grace still amazes me. Your grace still amazes me.
So the disciples have been on a 3-year journey with Jesus. They've been called away from their occupations. Not only did he call these four disciples, these four fishermen, he called, 12 disciples to make a very, very clear statement. He is the new Israel, gathering around him the new 12 tribes. You couldn't be more explicit. If you're a Jew, you're seeing the things Jesus is doing. You're just, he is making statements. As we said yesterday, or last week, he's the new Moses leading the new Exodus, right? He defeats the enemy in the wilderness. He succeeds where Israel fails, and he goes into the promised land. He's going to reconquer the promised land and restore God's rule to Israel, because that's exactly what the kingdom of God meant, the rule of God. Jesus is doing everything the Messiah was predicted to do. And so if you're a Galilean fisherman, you're just thinking, oh my gosh, this guy is really the real deal. This is legit. He is really going to deliver Israel. And so as you know the story, and I'm just counting on you guys that this video helped you, and that maybe your own study of the Gospels have helped you, you know that it kind of builds to this crescendo, which we call Palm Sunday, but they would call the triumphal entry. And so it builds to this point where Jesus and his disciples have now started to spend some time in this little town called Bethany, which is about a mile and a half away from Jerusalem, just on the other side of the Mountain of Olives. And they're sitting there in Bethany, and Jesus announced that it's time to go. The entire Galilean ministry, which is in the northern part of Israel, where Jesus has done a lot of his teaching, has been great. But they all know if he's really going to be the Messiah, he's got to claim the throne. And the throne is going to be at the capital in the southern part of the country, in Jerusalem. So now they've made their way down from the north, they're in the south, they're at this little tiny city called Bethany, which is an excellent strategic launching out point, where Jesus is now going to come into the city of Jerusalem and declare himself king. They're waiting for this. In fact, if you know the story, James and John, they're jockeying for position. They want to know who's going to be on the right hand and who's going to be on the left hand of Jesus in the kingdom. I mean, they're ready to go. They got their mom involved in it, which is a little bit, but that's what's going on with these guys, right? Ah, go ask him. It's a little embarrassing, but you get what I'm saying, right? They're ready to launch into this. So they're at Bethany. Jesus does something incredible at Bethany. He rises Lazarus from the dead. Right at the outskirt of Jerusalem, Jesus raises a man. In fact, the word gets out that there's this dead guy who's been brought back to life. People leave Israel, Jerusalem, to go to this little town just not only to meet Jesus, but to see, is this guy really alive again? I mean, read the book of John chapter 11 if you want details on that. I mean, that's what's going on here. This is right outside of the city of Jerusalem. Think about it if you're a disciple. You're like, look, we've got an invincible leader. I mean, if we get hungry, he can make food out of a lunch. If we get anyone that is injured, he can heal them on the spot. If anyone gets killed, he'll just rise them from the dead. I mean, who could stop this guy? We are going to march into Israel, Jerusalem, and we are going to kick Herod out of his throne, because he's not even a Jew. I mean, he doesn't belong on the throne of Israel. And we're going to put Jesus, the son of David, the rightful descendant of the great ancient King David, back on the throne. And we are going to rule, and God is going to finally liberate us from this oppressive rule of Rome. So that's where you're at. That's where I'm at. That's where I want us all to be mentally right now. If you're a lady, be Martha or Mary, or maybe the mother of James and John. Like, that's my boy. He's going to be on the, be in the story today. So Jesus now says to the guys, hey, go down into the town and go grab a donkey. Bring it to me, and if anyone asks you why you're untying the donkey, you tell them, because I need it. The master needs it. And Jesus, very symbolically, very intentionally, is going to fulfill Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9, Genesis chapter 49. He is going to ride into Israel on a donkey's colt, and he's going to hear the cries of Hosanna. That's exactly what happens. The next day, a large crowd gathered. A large crowd that had come to the feast, this is the feast of Passover, which will be very important in a moment, heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. Remember, he's just outside of the city. He crests the hill of the Mount of Olives, which is extremely symbolic for prophetic reasons. The Messiah is said to be landing on the Mount of Olives. So Jesus is cresting the hill of the Mount of Olives, a very, very mountain that was predicted the Messiah would enter on, and he enters the city. And what does the crowd say? It says, they say, Hosanna. Literally, that means God save. They are literally saying to Jesus, God save us, Son of David. Son of David was a title for the Messiah. So this crowd is saying, Messiah, save us. God save us. Save us from who? Save us from what? Save us from the oppression of our enemies. You are this Messiah. The crowd is welcoming. I can't imagine what it would have been like to be Peter as you see this. I mean, they say the disciples take off their own cloaks and let Jesus have like this royal entrance, like a red carpet kind of deal, into the city. Man, you're like, I've been at a couple state basketball games with the boys, you know, and they're ready to go in right before the game, and they're in the locker room, and they're pumping each other up, and they're screaming, and they're shouting, they're like, let's go! You know what I'm talking about? That's what's going on with these guys. They're like, it's go time, man. We're going to go into Jerusalem. We're going to kick Rome's butt. It's going to be awesome. That's what they're thinking. Let me play the story out. So Jesus enters into the city. It gets dark, so he must have entered the city kind of like maybe high noon, I don't know. But the sun goes down on him. It gets dark. But before it gets dark, if you read carefully, it says Jesus inspects the temple. The next morning, he goes right for the temple. Now, why is that important? The temple is it's like the capital city, or the capital building. So it's the seat of everything. We have this separation of church and state in our country. They didn't have that. The temple was the center of it all. Jesus goes right to the temple, and he does what every Jew knows. This is a defiled temple, and he cleanses it. As Messiah, he takes ownership of it, and he says, this is my Father's house. And I won't let this place be a den of iniquity. I won't let this place be a den of robbers. He cleanses the temple. I'm directly placing Jesus in confrontation with the religious leaders. Who's going to stop him? The crowd has just, the day before, said, you are the Messiah. So the religious leaders have no power. He basically goes in there and does what he wants. I can see Peter high-fiving Andrew. I can see this. They're like, yes, this is going to be great. Then this story kind of starts a turn. It's really close to Passover. And so Jesus says, I want to have a very special dinner with just you guys. And so they go to this very special place, they have a prepared room, and Jesus sits down with his disciples. And I can imagine Peter and the rest of the guys again saying, what an appropriate dinner to have right before battle tomorrow. I mean, what is Passover in the Jewish mind? It's the time when Israel is being delivered, right? I mean, what an appropriate meal, I can imagine them thinking. Of course, the new Moses is going to have Passover with us, and tomorrow it's on. Tomorrow it was on, but not like any of them thought. And at Passover, which we call the Lord's Supper, somewhere in the middle of that meal, it all turns. Jesus says, truly I say to you, one of you will betray me. You know the story, and if you read the Gospels together, you see that they all are doubting one another. There's this great question. You know, Leonardo has captured the scene, you know, with the great picture that we all have in our minds of questioning one of who in the world. What in the world? No way. We're about to tomorrow's victory day, not betrayal day. I mean, what is going on, right? There's this question of what's going on. You know, if you read John especially, John kind of tells you how Peter, how Judas and Jesus had that kind of a semi-private moment. Judas kind of gets the wink and the nod. Go do what you got to do. Judas suddenly leaves. No one knows why. Then Jesus takes those elements that are on the table, part of the feast, And what you also need to know is if you're a Jew and you're in the first century and you're doing Passover and you're the host, it's the job of the host to retell the story. Jesus is playing the role of the host, and so he's going to retell the Exodus story. But instead of the traditional retelling of the Exodus story, Jesus changes the whole story and puts himself as the center of it. And Jesus, as you know, as they were eating, Jesus broke bread, took bread, and after blessing it, he broke, gave it to his disciples. And he said, "Take and eat, this is my body." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, there it is on the screen, drink of it, all of you. Notice what he says, very interesting, and very, I'm sure, very mysterious to these disciples. "For this is my blood of the covenant." I don't have time to get into the significance of that word. That's a significant word in the Jewish mind. "This is the blood of my covenant, which is," this will be familiar to all of us, "which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." At this point, I think the disciples are completely clueless. Is this another one of those, you know, kind of enigmatic parables that we can't really understand? Jesus sometimes spoke in these parables. Sometimes the disciples would get, you know, kind of explained to them later. Is that another one of these? What is Jesus saying? The bread, the wine? How are these things him and the forgiveness of sins? We don't get it. They didn't get it. After this meal, they sing a celebratory hymn, and then they leave. They leave this prepared dinner, and Jesus takes them on a walk, and if you read John chapter 14 and John chapter 15 and 16 and 17, you kind of get the dialogue, but we're going to just fly through that. They cross down the Kidron Valley, cross the Kidron Brook, and they head up into this place called Gethsemane. And in Gethsemane, things really take a turn. In Gethsemane, everything seems to unravel for a disciple. It's been a long night, it's been a long day, a lot of things have been happening, but they notice Jesus' demeanor has totally changed. I want you to notice this. When they went to a place called Gethsemane, and he took with them Peter, James, and John, and I want you to note what they noticed. "And he began to be greatly distressed and troubled." You know, I have to say, I think that if you're a disciple, you've never seen Jesus distressed or troubled. Now, there have been plenty of times in the 3 years they've been together where they were distressed and troubled. Never was Jesus distressed or troubled. Remember the time on the Sea of Galilee? They're in the middle of the Sea of Galilee. A huge windstorm hits the lake. Waves that are swamping the boat. These seasoned fishermen are screaming, crying, thinking they're done, right? Jesus, where's he? He's asleep in the boat. You know, he doesn't care. It's like, he's actually, one of the Gospels says he's lying on the cushion. I thought that was awesome. You can bring a little pillow along, you know? He's like, "Oh, I'm tired. I'm going to get a little nap while these guys row across or something." I don't know. Jesus is sleeping in the boat. They wake him up. And he, I mean, you know, how would you like to be woken up in the middle of a storm? You're like, "Holy cow!" You know, Jesus' reaction is not "holy cow." His reaction is, "Stop. Wind, calm down." And where's your faith, you guys? That's his reaction, right? They're just like, "Are you kidding me? Like, how do you just like wake up and just say, stop, and everything obey you, and then you just ask us where our faith is? Like, who are you, right?" That's what they're saying to this guy, right? They've never seen Jesus like this. He's the one distressed. He's the one full of sorrows. And notice what he says. He says to them, "My soul is sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch." Going a little further, the other gospel says, "About the stone's throw away." So just throw the rock. He goes that far away. And so they can kind of hear his prayer to God. And they hear this cry, "Abba, Father." We spent a few minutes on this a few sermons ago about the intimacy of that term Abba, how unique that term Abba was in the first century for a Jew. It's that dad kind of cry. Jesus is crying out to God. And he's talking about this cup, and he's saying, "God, if it's possible, would you just let this cup pass through me?" And then as Steve said, I think it was in the first service, you know, but he says, "But not my will. Thy will be done." So the disciples are just tired. You know, they've had this long, this big meal, this Passover meal that has, you know, they're drinking wine. They're tired. So they're not staying awake for this. But Jesus comes three times and rouses them. Could you stay with me? Pray with me. I need you. Jesus has never needed them. Ever. And now he's this different person, it seems. Well, now the story really turns. The prophecy earlier that night that he would be betrayed is now going to be fulfilled. And so you got to picture this. You're on the side of the slope of the Mount of Olives. You're in this place called the Garden of Gethsemane. It's heavily wooded. You know, it's this area where not a lot of light would be. And you have walking up the trail, the flicker of torches and lanterns. This is not, you know, this is way before Thomas Edison. There's no lights unless there's a torch. I mean, it's very little light. And so you see this scene. And here comes these torches. So Judas, having procured a band of soldiers and some officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, went there with lanterns and torches and weapons. And so here comes this crowd. And so if you're a disciple, you're asleep, but then you kind of wake up to this noise of this coming group. And your first thought might be like, whoa, how'd they find us? What's going on? What's happening right now? Just like you might be if you were aroused in the middle of your sleep at home, hearing a noise in your living room. That happened to me once, which is another story I can tell you. It's unnerving, okay? There's a burglar in my house. But it's an extremely unnerving experience. And if you're Peter and the guys, all of a sudden you wake up and there's somebody that's coming after you with torches and weapons and lanterns, you're extremely unnerved. So what does Peter do? Because he thinks tomorrow is go time. Look what he does. This is what I would do. So it says in the middle of this, then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it. And he strikes the high priest's servant and cuts off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. This is just a neat little details there. So here's Peter. He's like, okay, they're bringing the fight to us. That's okay. I'm ready to go. We've got backup. We've got Jesus. There's no reason to, if they're going to bring the fight to us, that's fine with me. Let's get it on. And Peter, it stopped. Look at this. So Jesus says to Peter, put down your sword. If you're Peter, that's not what you think you're going to hear from the Messiah behind you. Remember the liberator of Israel? You're not thinking, put down your sword. I'm sure that if you're a private in a military, you know, and you're about ready to enter into hostile territory, the general doesn't say, hey guys, just put down your weapons. I mean, that is not a strategic move militarily. You guys all tracking? That is not what you're hearing if you're Peter. I'm sure Peter's out there like, I'm ready, God. Remember earlier I said I'd die with you? I'm ready, let's do it. Because I kind of really want to experience what Lazarus did. I mean, it'd be cool to die and come back to life. I want to experience that, you know? So Peter's out there. Put down your sword. Then he says, shall I not drink the cup that the Father has given me? That cup Jesus was praying about earlier, he's now resolved to drink that cup to finish his job, but in a way that no disciple was ever imagining. And so the temple guard takes Jesus. They take him into the temple area just outside, probably a house just outside of the temple court, not in the temple, but just outside of it, a large area. I'm not exactly quite sure where all this takes place. There's this courtyard area. And it may have been actually the temple, but just right outside there. And so they're in this temple area, this courtyard area. John knows someone in the temple hierarchy, and so John gets permission to come into the actual trial area. And because John has a connection, he gets Peter into the outer court area. So Peter can't really see all that's going on, but he's a part of the peanut gallery, kind of hearing what's going on. Remember, the light is really bad, it's really dark, it's really dimly lit, and so you have this kind of, you have a couple of fires where people are keeping themselves warm. You have all these people wondering what's going on. And you have this trial taking place where Caiaphas, the leader of the head high priest, is now accusing Jesus of being a false Messiah. John, like I said, is witnessing this. Peter's outside. But what's not happening is there's no resistance on Jesus' part. Absolutely none. In fact, many times where Jesus could rightly defend himself, he remains silent. And in the few things he does say, he literally incriminates himself. If you're a disciple, you're like, what is he saying? What is he not doing? Why is he not fighting? I mean, we've seen him do things we can't even explain. What is he doing now? This lion has become a lamb. What's going on? And so now, I want to talk about Peter. So you've been following Jesus for 3 years. You've been called out of a fisherman's life into this journey of a disciple, and you've seen things you can't explain. But now, you're at the darkest place of your life. And I want to go through the denial. Watch this. Watch what happens. Now, Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard, and a servant girl came up to him, and he said to him, "You also were with Jesus the Galilean." I'm going to explain that in one moment. But he denied it before them all, saying, "I do not know what you mean." Okay, let's explain. So this is not a private conversation between Jesus and a little girl. This little girl, servant girl, comes up to Peter. They're in that peanut gallery. There's a crowd there. And he says, "You were with that Jesus the Galilean." Now, why is that so significant? Well, because, remember I told you in the very beginning of our sermon that there were other Messiah movements in the first century? One of the Messiah movements, around 6 AD, was a guy named Judas. His title was Judas the Galilean. Any guesses what happened to Judas the Galilean? The fact that we don't know much about him kind of is evidence. Okay? The fact you have never heard of him probably is probably the evidence. Judas gets this group of Galileans around him. Rome comes at him, kills him, and hunts down as many of those followers as they can to make examples, including his own two kids, who both get crucified. Let me tell you, if you're Peter from Galilee, you already have a reputation of being kind of a riotous kind of part of the country. And this girl saying you're part of that Jesus the Galilean is exactly what would have been said if you were a part of Judas the Galilean's movement. I think that charge struck fear deep in the heart of Peter. Because remember, Peter has no clue what's going on. Peter's thinking, are you kidding me? I thought we were going to be conquering Rome, and it looks like he's getting conquered right in front of us. And so Peter's like, I don't know what you mean. As little time goes past, Jesus continues to not defend himself. And Peter's outside. Look what happens next. And he went out to the entrance. Another servant girl saw him. And said to the bystanders, "This man was with Jesus of Nazareth." Now that was more a more common title for Jesus. He's more commonly referred to as Jesus of Nazareth. That's why the Jesus of the Galilean was such a significant thing to say. So this man was also with Jesus of Nazareth. And again, he denied it with an oath. "I do not know the man." Guys, remember earlier in the book of Matthew, Jesus told us on the Sermon on the Mount not to make oaths. Peter directly disobeys that order and says, "By the temple, I do not know this man." Third denial. After a little while, the bystanders came up to Peter. "Certainly, you too are one of them, for your accent betrays you." See, the Galileans had this very funny sounding accent in Aramaic. And the southerners, the people in the south, the people that lived in the capital, the Judeans, hated the way they spoke up in North Galilee. It sounded like a redneck to them. They would actually make fun of the way they spoke. In fact, if you were a Galilean and you had the Galilean accent, you were not allowed to pray at the synagogue because they thought your prayers sounded so weird and uneducated. That's seriously true. And so he sticks out like a sore thumb. Every time he talks, he incriminates his identity. And so here's Paul, Peter, and they're saying, "You definitely are one of these Galileans. I can tell by how you speak." What Peter says in response, I think, is such a window into how he's feeling. Look what he says. "Then he began to invoke a curse." Now, the next two words are not in the Greek. The next two words are what, you know, translators do to kind of help make the sentence make sense. In the Greek, Both Matthew and Mark intentionally leave it ambiguous as to what he's cursing. From the context and from the actual word used for curse, it's really clear who he's cursing is actually Jesus.
That's right.
Because the word for curse is the word kata anathema. In Mark, it's just anathema, which is exactly the thing that the early Christians who were persecuted were forced to say if they wanted to recant their faith. What they were forced to say was, I curse the name of Jesus. Jesus' name is anathema. That's exactly what Peter is saying here. I curse his name. And then he says, then he makes another swear, and he says, I do not know the man. I was talking to Steve after the last service, and really, that is so literally true. I think Peter is saying, look, he's not who I thought he was. I don't even know this guy. Because who I thought he was Rome's conqueror, not the one going to get conquered. Who I thought he was going to be our deliverer, and it looks like he needs someone to deliver him right now. Peter's legs have been totally knocked out from underneath him. And when the rooster crows, I think it drives Peter crazy. Because obviously, Peter then reflects back to what Jesus said just hours earlier that said, Peter, I know you think you'll die with me, but you'll deny me three times before the rooster crows. When that rooster crows, he's probably just so crazy. It's like, man, what is going on with this? How can a guy who knows so much, who can do such things, not deliver us? Because the Greek word for weeping bitterly is this word violently. He goes out and he weeps violently. Because remember, Peter doesn't know Easter's coming. All Peter knows is his world has been turned upside down. So now let's go to the last part of the story. The next morning, and you read The Passion of the Christ, if you watch that movie, and I encourage you to watch that movie this time of year, it's just a great movie. There's a scene from it. Pilate, and if you read the gospel stories, you know Pilate's been kind of almost put into this spot where he's literally forced to consent to the crucifixion of Christ. He knows he's an innocent man. But maybe just to dig it into the Jews, a little bit of a counterpunch, he writes on the title that goes over the cross, he writes, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Here's your king, you Jews. We're going to crucify him. If you're a Jew, and you want to make sure someone's cursed, you hang them on a tree. I think Caiaphas pushed very, very strongly for the crucifixion so that everyone would know Jesus was accursed on a tree. They took the crown of thorns. They put them on his head. Interestingly, I said this in the last verse. Interestingly, think about it. A crown of thorns only exists because of the curse of man. If you know your Bible back into Genesis, thorns came from our curse. God, in his sovereign wisdom, knew that one day his son would die on the cross and on his very mind would rest our very curse. And then he is crucified on this cross. And if you step back and you saw the image because of how they crucified you in a semi-seated position with a crown of thorns on your head and your arm stretched out up high in a semi-seated position, it would look exactly like a king being coronated on his coronation day. Jesus was crowned and enthroned in a way no one could ever imagine. Not on a crown of gold or ivory, but on a wooden cross. No disciple understands what's going on. In fact, every disciple is gone except one. It's only John. He's the only eyewitness to the crucifixion. The women disciples are there. They're a little more courageous than the men for whatever reason. The women are there. Mary's there. The other Mary, Martha, they're there. Another lady, Susanna. They're watching Jesus crucified. Look at the story. Look at the text. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull, when they crucified him, they divided his garments among them by casting lots. And they sat down and kept watch over him there. And over his head they put the charge against him, which read, this is Jesus, the King of the Jews. Then two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right, one on the left. And those who were passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying, notice what they say to Jesus. This is clear evidence of the claims that Jesus had made prior to this. Notice what they say. You who would destroy the temple, river, when he judged the temple. You who would destroy our capital and rebuild it in 3 days. Save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross. So also the chief priests with the scribes and the elders mocked him, saying, he saved others. He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross and we will believe him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him if he desires him. For he said, I'm the Son of God. If you're a disciple and you're hearing everything your master said, now turn around and cast in your teeth. Mock, use those same words, and now use those words to mock him. I mean, doesn't it undermine everything Jesus did if you're a disciple? Doesn't this erase all of what you thought up to this point? It has to. I think it's worse. The robbers who were crucified with him in the same way also reviled him in the same way. And from the ninth hour, from the sixth hour, there was darkness over all the land to the ninth hour. The light of the world is being extinguished in front of our eyes. And the sun is darkened. If you guys can picture out of the darkness, and this is so interesting, the last words that Matthew records. Now we know there are other gospels that record a few other things Jesus says, but from Matthew's viewpoint, the last words you hear Jesus say this side of Easter, this. Eli, Eli, lama, sabbath. My God, why have you forsaken me? So let me get this straight. We have the head disciple cursing Jesus' name and saying he doesn't know him. And then we have Jesus himself saying from the cross he's been forsaken by God. So I got a really interesting question. Why are we here today? How in the world did the Jesus movement survive this? We're going to tell you next week. So you got to come back. But before we get to next week, I want a week of meditation. Guys, I said this earlier. I think we both suffer and benefit from knowing the end of the story. The way we benefit is hard to even calculate. But the way we suffer is we don't really maybe experience what it would have been like to be Peter or Martha or Mary or John. So what I want you to do, I want you to think like you're a disciple. And this person you were convinced is the Messiah has now been executed in front of your very eyes. Guys, has God ever just not made sense to you? Has there been things that happened in your life that you're just like, I have no idea what God is doing right now? Guys, let me tell you. That is a common experience among the disciples of Jesus. Sometimes we just have no idea what he's doing. But when Easter comes, everything changes. So friends, what I want us to do right now, I want us to think about what Jesus did for us. Suffered. Poured out his blood for you and for me. How would it have been to hear those haunting words? Why have you forsaken me? It's the light of the world. It's extinguished. what I'm going to do right now, just kind of end our service, kind of in a meditative place, kind of just meditate. Just going to leave the lights kind of low and maybe turn on the back light so no one hurts itself. But just kind of quietly. Maybe you just want to sit and think for a little while. And just reflect as a disciple would reflect. Let me tell you, guys, if you really do this, what we talk about next week is going to be amazing. If you really let yourself feel what they must have felt like next week, it's going to be very convincing. I'm going to pray, and we'll be dismissed. Father, God, thank you for what you did for us. I'm so thankful that you preserved the story for us in the Bible so that we could read it and understand it. God, I thank you for just this journey we went on today as a church. Father, I pray that if there are people here today that they've never yet become followers of Jesus, they don't understand what it means to be a follower of Jesus. They heard a sermon about a guy who died on the cross. Lord, I pray that today they could see that death on the cross paid the sin penalty that all of us owed you. That you were rightfully angry with us because of our disobedience to you, our disregard for you, just our plain just ignoring you. And rather than pour out that anger on us, you did the unimaginable. You became a man. And you took the wrath that was pointed our way. Father, if there's someone here today that has not yet put their trust in Jesus, God, may they see that only in Jesus is their protection from the judgment that we all deserve. Only in Jesus is their grace. And in Christ, you are no longer our judge, but you are our Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you'd like to talk to any of the pastors afterward, we'll be here. But I'd like the church just to be just this kind of quietly. Thank you very much.